Welcome to March Madness with our theme of the month, Distractions. I'm Penny Beeman with Uber Paws of Love, and I have service dog Azul and my rescue dog Cam that are in a lot of my videos and things online. I also write the blogs that are on the uberpaws.com website. So I hope you enjoy the fun we're going to have tonight and check out the website to see what's happening the rest of the month.
And I'm Cindy Campbell of Cindy Campbell Dog Training, and I have service dog Nick and retired service dog Poe. They're both in a lot of my video. Nick's more in my videos, but they're both in my videos. And I have the blogs, The Adventures of Nick the Service Dog and Cindy Campbell Dog Training. So we're the two wild women of dog training, and we prefer to have fun and have fun with our dogs.
Because if it isn't fun, you shouldn't do it.
Right.
Have an alarm ringing.
And we should, and our dogs should be having fun too, because they don't want to do it if it's not fun.
Exactly. I don't think we would have to argue with people much to say that everybody pretty much knows that distractions are everywhere. So it doesn't matter what's most distracting to your dog, whether it's that squirrel or the bird, cat, dog, giraffe, people, cars, distractions are everywhere. What do we do about them? You want to give me an example, Cindy, of one of Nick's most high distractions?
Well, Nick loves squirrels and cats. And if he thinks there's a cat outside my apartment, he will go start bugging me to go outside. It's that bad. And he wants to go cat hunting. And then he's all alert and looking around, and he's got his eyes open. And if he had a wreck, he's a poodle, so he can't do his ears up. But if he could put his ears up, they'd be up and they'd be twitching, looking which direction. Where's the cat? Where's that cat? And it's been a long, I don't want to say battle's not the right word. It's been a process. Long process to get him to where he is today. I can now take him out on a buckle collar with a leash, and he still might be in that, where's that cat? Where's that cat? Let me get that cat mode. But he'll listen to me. And it's been 100% done with playing with him and getting his focus back on me, because I'm way more fun than a cat, even though he might think the cat is more fun.
Exactly. Biggest distractions. Well, his main two are dogs, and it's the dog he doesn't know, because if he's friends with the dog, he's excited for a minute, but he calms right down and ready to go to work still. But if it's a dog he's never seen, then he doesn't want to turn his back on the dog. He wants to get as close and collect as much information as possible. The other thing that really super distracts him, of course, being a service dog, he's out in the community a lot, but his other big thing is kids, especially little girls around 3 to 4 years old.
Those are heartthrob.
He knows they all want to pet him, and he wants to be pet by all of them. So kind of case in point, the other day we were out and about, and he had given 2 medical alerts within probably maybe 2 minutes of each other, maybe 3 minutes of each other. It just wasn't getting better. So he was reminding me, hey, you need to take this seriously. And then about a minute after that, I mean, I did take it seriously and we did something, but about a minute after that, a 3-year-old girl came in, and sure enough, all the alerts stopped and he was totally in pet me mode, not his work mode that I wanted him to be in the situation. So that's one of his uber distractions. Most other things he can work around. But how did we get to that point? Again, it was a long journey. So we want to talk just a little bit about things that you notice when your dog is distracted, the kinds of things that you can see in your dog. So you already mentioned the ears. What are some of the other things that Nick may do when he is distracted?
Well, often his you can just see his body stiffens, his tail goes up, and he's fluffy because he's a corded standard poodle. So he's got like dreadlocks on. So you can see so his hair doesn't stand up like it might on, he can't really hackle the way Azul might, but you can just see the tension in his body. You can kind of see his ears move a little bit and his head will turn like he's scanning and looking for what his item, his interest is, whether it's a cat, a kitten, raccoon, who knows what's out here. Hopefully not a bobcat or a cougar, but he's looking for something.
Now, Azul is a little bit different because if he's distracted most of the time, he knows exactly where it is. You know, he sees it, he hears it, he's locked onto it. So while he might stiffen a little bit, he's actually mastered the like calm, I'm in control kind of deceiving look. He looks calm and in control. He's not. If you watch him, you have to watch really, really close to see that like his nose all of a sudden sped up and it's almost twitching like, you know, like when a dog's scratching their ear, that shake, his nose is almost vibrating like that.
And well, Nick, go ahead.
I was gonna say, and so he might like pull at the leash. He might just lean into it a little bit because until the distraction gets close, he doesn't really pull. But you can tell by like instead of being nice and centered on all four legs, and you know, in that just natural pose, he leans more toward the front. Like he's leaning toward it. Can I get a little bit closer? Can I get a little bit closer? And then well, at the last minute, when that distraction gets closer, then he wants to rush in for the greeting. It's always a happy greeting, but it's still, he wants to rush in.
Well, Nick's actually goes into hunting mode, and it's taken a lot just to get him back to where he's at now. Normally, he would have his initial response was to freeze, and he'd actually point. And so if you've ever seen a dog in the field pointing, poodles are actually retrieving dogs, so they're in the same class as labs and German short hair pointers and wired hair pointers, and so they do point. But he would actually point. Fortunately, we've gotten past where he does that because that's really hyper alert to whatever he's actually in stalking mode when he does that.
Yeah. Azul
and I do not want that.
Wildlife. But
it, yeah. Well, it doesn't have to be at wildlife.
Like I could always call him away from it, you know? So he pointed out, he likes it. It's interesting, but it's not a major distraction that causes lack of focus or makes his brain check out so that he can no longer hear me.
Yeah. And that's what we've been working on. A couple of other key points
to distractions. You know that if the dog is not listening to you, it's probably due to the fact that they can't hear you anymore.
And they can't think.
Hear you simply because their excitement level is too high beyond what they can control.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason I chose distractions for the month of March is because in my neck of the woods, where we still have lots of snow on the ground and it's really cold, it's a little bit more prominent, but everybody experiences a type of spring fever, or it doesn't necessarily have to be weather related, but a lot of times if you have a bad weather season or a bad health season in your life, or something that causes you to be a little bit slower over the course of a couple of months, when that season passes and you can now be busy again. I mean, imagine if you broke your leg and you couldn't do anything for 2 months. By the time that 2 months is over, you are going stir crazy and you wanna go. Well, our dogs go through that same thing when we have been slow and they've been slow, like Azul's not getting the walks. So that makes now going on a 1 mile walk, where we used to walk 3-4 miles easy, but a 1 mile walk is now overexciting to him. And by the time we get done with the 1 mile, yes, he could physically go more, but he can't mentally go more because he's in that spring fever kind of mode. So everything becomes overstimulating again.
And you have in my neck of the, in my neck of the woods, I live in California. I don't live in the mountains in California. I live in the valley. I live in the Central Valley, and we don't get snow. We might get snowflakes every 10 years and they won't stick. So we get fog, but that doesn't mean that you're going to be inside all day. But what does happen in the spring is all the baby birds, all the baby bunnies, all the baby wildlife start to come out, and the trees are in blossom. There's a lot of plants that come up, new plants that have new smells that come up. And so there's a whole new sense. Even if you've been walking miles all year long, there's a whole new level of sensory coming out. Last year, when we were walking our normal trail that we walk, we were watching the baby geese, and we watched them from the time they just hatched till they were ready to start flying, and they started flying with their parents. So, and that's a distraction, because you have the cute little baby geese, and then you have the parents that are on guard, and they literally are on guard. And there's a perimeter of adult geese patrolling the baby geese. So you have to think about things like that as distractions, because it's not what you're normally seeing, because the rest of the year there's not baby geese.
And exactly. That's especially true for like dogs that are very scent oriented, like the Zulas, mm-hmm. that follow their nose, hunting dogs, things like that. Because
it's lambing season here. Calving goes on all year, depending on cow and heifer, but it's definitely lambing season.
There are so many animals that mate or have birth mm-hmm. in the spring. And creates new smells, like you mentioned, the parent ducks and the babies. They both have different smells, and it may have been a year since that dog has smelled baby ducks before, or baby bunnies, or the babies smell different than adults.
So that and
really overwhelm our scent-driven dogs.
So the parents were on one side of the trail behind a chain link fence where the dogs weren't in theory supposed to be able to get. They still had guard geese on the other side of the trail, on the other side of a creek, standing around making sure nobody was getting into their space. Right. So you have to watch for stuff like that, because the distraction may not, you may think the distraction is where, look at the cute little baby geese. You may think that's the distraction, but the distraction may be completely on the other side, because somebody standing guard, of what's going on. And then you have to worry about things like, we had a mountain lion that came down from the foothills into a neighborhood last week. So, you just have to think of, these things happen.
We have that issue too, because as weather warms up, we start to have the bears come out of hibernation, the skunks come out of hibernation. So all these animals, thankfully, Azul has never seen a skunk. Cam has only once in the 7 or 8 years we've had him. He ate a baby skunk once for a little while. Didn't last long. It came right back up and ran away safely. Blew my mind. But that was a distraction when he was much more prey-driven. Now at his older age, he's not quite that prey-driven. And unless it's a good deer that will run from him, he doesn't usually give chase. But knowing that those distractions are new and revived in the spring can be a huge difference to the way your dog is behaving and how they're reacting in the environment you're putting them in.
And it can revive
on life. That environment you choose is very, very important this time of year.
And it revives those drives.
Right. So that's my March Madness theme this month. It's all about learning the distractions that are common for your area, how to read your dog when they're seeing a distraction. And then to end the month, and I'm excited about this because this is like one of my all-time favorite classes I do, I have it both virtually and in person. But the focus around distractions class, we're going to do as a mini workshop filled with videos and all kinds of great information from March 21st to March 24th. So that's a Monday through Thursday. Might just have a little bit of overflow and bonus information on Friday if people are interested. And you can find out more about that on my uberpaws.com website. It's going to run right through the website, so I'm not going to require any kind of registration. It'll be open source. As many people can view it as possible because we are just going to have fun with it. So I hope to see you all back. I hope you tune in. I know, Cindy, you'll be helping me, and I'll have a few other trainers helping as well. So enjoy the month and enjoy spring. Hopefully we have some nice weather right around the corner.
Hopefully. We're supposed to get rain tomorrow, so we're all excited.
All right. Have a good night, people.
Good night.